إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار All praise and thanks belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, we thank Him, we seek His help and we seek His forgiveness. Whomsoever Allah guides, there's none that can misguide. Whomsoever He misguides, there's none to guide. And I bear witness that there's nothing worthy of our worship except for Allah Azza wa Jal alone, without any partner or associate. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the slave of Allah and his messenger, and he is the seal of all the prophets, alayhi salatu wa salam. And indeed, the best of speech is the speech of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and the best of guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of affairs and matters are those which are newly introduced into the deen of Allah. For every newly religious matter into this deen, it is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is a source of deviation and misguidance. And every misguidance leads to the hellfire. We ask Allah to protect us all from that. Allahumma ameen. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we are all very familiar and acquainted with the certain things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has preferred over others. Like this Jumu'ah, this day of Friday, being the most preferred day to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the best day of the week. And we know that Ramadan is a chosen month by Allah azza wa jal as the best of the months from the year. And we have from places which are more preferred and they excel others all over the earth. And from those is Mecca, it is Medina, it is Bayt al-Maqdis, and so on and so forth. And there is people which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preferred over others, and they are the prophets. And from the prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is preferred above them all. So the list can go on and on over things which Allah has given significance instead of others. But are we familiar and acquainted with which words are more beloved to Allah? Which words and phrases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most and He has preferred them over the rest of speech, over the rest of any sentence you can make in your life? What are those words which Allah azza wa jal loves and He has preferred? There's a hadith collected by Imam Muslim, the hadith of Samurah ibn Jundub radiallahu anhu, in which he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أحب الكلام إلى الله أربعة. He said that most beloved of speech to Allah, it is four, meaning four phrases. And he says, alayhi salatu wasalam, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. So these four phrases are Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, and la ilaha illallah, and Allahu akbar. Out of all the speech in the world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved these four phrases the most. So these phrases, they revolve around the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who Allah is, His attributes, and His perfect sifat and traits that He has, Azza wa Jal. So there's many a hadith from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in which these four phrases are mentioned in terms of their virtues. But this hadith alone, Ahabul Kalam in Allah, that the most beloved of speech to Allah is these four phrases, this is enough for us to accept it as it is, and that we should use them and act upon them. Nevertheless, there's virtues which the Prophet ﷺ mentioned. And we will mention a couple of ahadith, maybe two or three, just to emphasize this and to learn about these phrases and how important they are in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the virtues of these four statements, these four phrases of dhikr is that these are the best phrases upon which the sun rises on. The best phrases upon which the sun rises on. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says, لِأَنْ أَقُولْ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ. For me to say, سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ, it is more beloved to me than over anything upon which the sun rises on. And the sun rises on everything that you see, subhanAllah. So these four phrases are more beloved to the Prophet than anything upon which the sun rises on. Yet these four words are easy for us to pronounce. And the goodness that comes in return is something which we cannot really fathom. We cannot really truly comprehend what's behind that, subhanAllah. Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, he narrates that while him and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and a few of other companions, they were walking by some trees. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he had a stick with him. So while they were walking, he struck one of the trees which had dry leaves. And then all of a sudden, all of those leaves from the trees, from that tree, they fell. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, إِنَ الْحَمْدِ لِلَّهِ وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ لَتُسَاقِطُ مِنْ ذُنُوبِ الْعَبْدِ كَمَا تُسَاقَطْ وَرَقُ هَذِهِ الْجَنَّةِ هَذِهِ شَجَرَةٌ. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, that these four phrases, again, subhanAllah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, they fall like the sins from the people, from the abd, from the slave of Allah, from the worship of Allah. They fall like his sins, just like the leaves fall from the tree. So just as the leaves fall from the tree, likewise, people who say these phrases, their sins will fall off themselves, you know, off their bodies, subhanAllah. So all of us are in need of expiating our sins. So by simply saying these four phrases, our sins would fall off like the leaves do from the trees. Wallahu Akbar. In another narration, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he goes on further to emphasize the virtue of these four phrases. And this following narration was authenticated by Shaykh al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. It is the hadith of a sahabiya, Umhani. Umhani is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She is the daughter of Abu Talib. She once came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and saying to him, Ya Rasulullah, I've gotten old and I've gotten weak and I've even gained weight. Guide me to a deed that I can do, meaning something easy that I can do. So he said to her sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كَبِّرِ اللَّهَ مِيَةَ مَرَّةً وَأَحْمَدِ اللَّهَ مِيَةَ مَرَّةً وَسَبِّحِ اللَّهَ مِيَةَ مَرَّةً خير من مئة فرس ملجم مسرج في سبيل الله وخير من مئة بدنة وخير من مئة رقبة. He says عليه الصلاة والسلام to her, say Allahu Akbar, كبر الله, proclaim the greatness of Allah 100 times. وحمد الله, and say praise Allah 100 times. Say Alhamdulillah 100 times. And glorify Allah by saying Subhanallah 100 times. That is better than 100 horses bridled and saddled in the cause of Allah. And it is better than 100 sacrificial camels. Badana are the camels and the most expensive to sacrifice. And better than freeing 100 slaves. Subhanallah. In another narration similar to this one, it adds, وَهَلِّلِلَّهَ مِئَةَ تَهْلِيلًا. And say, La ilaha illallah 100 times as well. And the narrator of this hadith, he says, أَحْسِبُ, I believe, from what was said, is that the goodness is equivalent to the distance between the heavens and the earth, just by saying, La ilaha illallah 100 times. SubhanAllah. Walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. These four words, they carry so much more reward than we may have thought, if this is the first time that we have heard this. And in fact, these four words are also a sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which we should use after the faridah, after the mandatory prayers, just as we make subhanAllah 33 times, alhamdulillah 33, and Allah 33 or 34. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in a hadith, when a companion came to him and said, I saw in a dream where someone came to me and said to me, didn't your Prophet command you to say subhanAllah 33 times after the end of every prayer, and alhamdulillah 33 times, and Allahu Akbar 33 times? He said, I said yes. So the person in the dream said to him, to his companion, make it 25, subhanAllah. Make it 25, alhamdulillah. Make it 25, Allahu Akbar. And add 25, la ilaha illallah, which completes 100. So then he went to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and he told him, I saw this in a dream. What should I do? He says to him, اجعلوها كذلك. Make it like that. Make it 25 after salah. Many people are accustomed to just saying 33 times, alhamdulillah and so on, which is fine and all well. And of course, that is the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But there's other ways, other varieties of dhikr that we can do after our prayers. And this is one of them, that you say subhanAllah, walhamdulillah, wala ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, and you say this 25 times on each finger like that, which completes 100, subhanAllah. So again, it's no surprise that these phrases are blessed and they have many virtues, then we should be keen to observe them and say them, inshallah. They are the most beloved of speech and praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what we made mention of in the first part of this khutbah were just of the few of the blessings and virtues behind the tasbih and tahmid and tahleel and takbir. Yani subhanallah walhamdulillah wala ilaha illallah wallahu akbar. And we learned that these are in fact the most beloved of words and phrases to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And while we know this, and we know what's behind them in terms of reward and virtues and blessings, we should not neglect to know the meaning of these terms. We should know what we are saying to add to the blessing, inshallah ta'ala. It is important that we know the meanings of these terms. So this ahadith, they usually typically mention subhanAllah first, then alhamdulillah, then Allahu Akbar, then la ilaha illallah, then Allahu Akbar. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in the same hadith which we read, but I did not mention, he said, it does not matter which one you begin with. It does not matter which one you begin with. So, in all cases, we'll begin with a tasbih. Subhanallah. What does it mean? Subhanallah, that is, when we say subhanallah, we are glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all weakness and deficiency. That Allah is far removed from any deficiency, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any defect, right? So when we say subhanallah, we are saying Allah is perfect. Allah is perfect and He's far removed from any shortcoming, any mistake. He's far removed from having a son. He's far removed from having an associate and a rival. Subhanallah. Subhanallah amma yushrikun. Ta'ala Allah, right? Allah is high above from what people say about Him, what they attribute to Him, which does not belong to Him. Allah is far removed from His creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing to do with His creation. Everything in creation that you see has some defect and it will vanish. But Allah Azza wa Jal, He's back. He's ever living, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's not like His creation, Azza wa Jal. Subhanallah. So when we say subhanallah, we're actually saying Allah is perfect. Right? Allah is perfect, far removed from what people attribute to Him in terms of shufa'ah and idols, intermediaries, which Allah did not give any authority for having a child. Subhanallah. Again, all of this is imperfection if we were to attribute it to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after subhanallah, we say a tahmid, which is alhamdulillah. This is all of us know it, alhamdulillah. We praise Allah. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we say alhamdulillah. But more specifically, more in depth, what we are saying is every single unconditional praise or thanks is exclusively to the one who deserves it. The one who deserves worship. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah is very deep in Arabic. Right? In English, we translate it as thanks be to Allah and praise be to Allah. But in Arabic, it's more, you know, more detailed, if you will. Because alhamdulillah, when you look at it linguistically, it goes down quite a deep path that it means it's an unconditional praise. Unconditional. Meaning whether you give thanks or not, alhamdulillah, it belongs to Him anyway. You know, it's definite, does not change. It's always there, whether you do it or not. To Allah belongs all alhamd. Right? Allah loves alhamd. Allah starts many surahs by alhamd. Many surahs end by alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Right? So this is throughout the Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves alhamd, and it's something which the Prophet ﷺ, he would say in times of pleasure and displeasure. So So when he would hear good news, he would say, Alhamdulillah, alladhi bi ni'mati tatimu salihat. That praise be to Allah, Alhamdulillah, that by His grace, you know, the good deeds are completed. And if he heard bad news, he would say, Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. Right? Alhamdulillah in all circumstances. So Alhamdulillah fil ula wa fil akhirah, as Allah says in the Quran. To Him, from the beginning to the end, whether people do it or not, to Him belongs Alhamd, Subhanallah. Then after the tahmid, after Alhamdulillah, we have the phrase of Tawheed, which is La ilaha illallah. And this is the most important of all dhikr. All supplications, all remembrances that we say, this is the best and the most important of all of them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for La ilaha illallah. Allah created us for the purpose of La ilaha illallah, which means that we worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we worship Him. It is what distinguishes Muslims from non-Muslims. It's La ilaha illallah. Right? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the prophets? Why He revealed the books, the Torah, and the Injil, and the Quran, and so on? Only because of La ilaha illallah. So what does it mean? This statement is divided into negation and affirmation. Meaning we negate in the first part, and then we affirm in the second. So when we say La ilaha, that there is no God, that there is nothing worthy of worship, we negate any veneration, any ibadah. Whether it's worshipping a false God, whether it's worshipping Jesus Christ, a prophet, the sun, or the moon, or a saint, money, even our ego. None of this deserves worship, right? So we negate it. La ilaha. There's nothing worthy of worship. So we negate veneration and ibadah for every object, and then we affirm it. Illa Allah. Except for Allah. We affirm it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of that belongs only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the only being who I'm going to venerate and worship, and I'm going to take Him as my judge, and I'm going to give Him my ultimate love, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only one I'm going to sacrifice for is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ilaha illallah. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, this is the heaviest deed on the scale on the Day of Judgment. The heaviest deed on the mizan is La ilaha illallah. And he says alayhi salatu wasalam, whoever says La ilaha illallah sadiqan min qalbihi, sincerely out of his heart, he will enter Jannah. Subhanallah. So La ilaha illallah is no doubt the best of all adhkar. Then we have a takbir, which is Allahu Akbar. And this is a statement of glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We proclaim Allah's greatness when we say Allahu Akbar. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of the past, he said many of our rituals, like the salah, the hajj, the siyam, the fasting, the adhan for the five daily prayers, our eids that we have, Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Fitr, they all incorporate the phrase of takbir, all of them. They have Allahu Akbar within them. So we proclaim Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greatness at every opportunity, and the very fact that we begin our prayers by saying Allahu Akbar, this is enough to show us the fadl, as a virtue, as a blessing of this statement alone, that we say Allahu Akbar when we begin our prayers. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us from what we've heard, and to give us the ability to practice and observe these statements. Allahu Ameen. Allahumma alimna ma anfa'una wa anfa'na bima alamtana wa zidna ilman. Allahumma atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'ah wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna istinabah. Allahumma ya munqalib al-qulubi wal absar thabbit quluban ala dinik. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر فبدأ فيه بنفسه، فقال جل من قال عليما، إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. هذا والحمد لله رب العالمين.